Rudy, what do your peeps tell you?
I want to go back to something that John said about this being a miscalculation by the president, a miscalculation in terms of the politics. I, with all due respect, disagree. I think he knows exactly what he's doing. I think there was a lot of malice at the end of the speech when he mentions the fact that this is no reason to close government down. That's precisely, he says it. It reminded me of when Nixon says, I'm not a crook. He says it because that's precisely what he's hoping to bait the Republicans to do. And I think sensible Republicans, the Paul Ryans of the world, the Mario Diaz-Balarts of the world, the Marco Rubios of the world, need to take control of the caucus. And yes, there are going to be some extreme crazy things meant said by Ted Cruz, but we need to ignore the Ted Cruz and the Steve Kings and act as reasonable adults. And if we act as reasonable adults, we'll be rewarded by voters in 2016.
There's no question. You have a couple of people who say something on either side, and it's not necessarily emblematic.
Right.
Al Sharpton, I don't know, is really representative, is the face of the Democratic Party, though some people might think so. But the fact of the matter is that it's a very complex issue, and there is concern, and we don't really know the details yet, John. Let me just read a couple of things that we do know. Number one, you must meet strict requirements to qualify for relief from deportation. Eligible immigrants will have the opportunity to request temporary relief from deportation and work authorization if they come forward and pass criminal and national security background checks, pay their taxes, pay a fee, and show that they are a parent of U.S. citizens or lawful permanent residents on the date of the announcements. And also, you can't apply for this for several months. Borders have not been secure.
Well,
what's your bet of what's going to happen on the border?
They're going to continue securing the border. I thought the president was very effective last night when he said the number of people crossing the border have dropped to levels we haven't seen since 1970. I think everything he said in the speech was right on.
Okay, but can I ask you something?
Sure.
This is also the president that said the border's secure, and one of the reasons the legislation, immigration legislation, as I'm told by members of Congress from both sides, wasn't presented in June is because the border wasn't secure and you had thousands of unaccompanied minors crossing the border.
Well, that was a blip. I mean, that was obviously a problem in terms of enforcement, but I mean, it's a great tragedy to have these children coming over to our country. We need to help these children.
Not separated from their parents, John.
No, but we need to help these children.
I mean, what's a tragedy is what's happening in their country, but I'm sorry, being five or six and being like in an orphanage
is like not fun. It's a very complex issue, but when you have a child who's coming here, escaping, and the parents are giving their children up to this country like the Cubans did during the Pedro Pan period, people are leaving their country because they're in danger.
There's no question about that.
They
but it shows that
helped.
the border wasn't secure then. How can you be so confident that
it will never be 100%, and everybody knows that. It's ridiculous. 80%?
Can we expect 80%?
We don't live in an armed camp here in the United States of America. We should have policies which there should be a downturn in terms of immigration coming into the country. It should be orderly. Everybody agrees to that. But we're not going to live in an armed camp. It's impossible. When the president talked last night that the numbers of immigration across the border are down to the levels that we haven't seen in 40 years, that's pretty impressive.
Here's the problem with that. He's got a credibility issue. You know, people don't trust President Obama anymore. This is the same guy that told you during the now infamous Obamacare push that if you like your insurance, you were going to get to keep it. That clearly has been proven wrong, and so have a number of the other, you know, misfacts that he's put out there. So he's got a credibility issue, and that hampered the ability to pass legislation because a lot of Republicans who would like to see the right thing done here don't trust this president to enforce the laws.
Wait, if I can just say one thing. We can't lose sight. This is not about policy. This is about real human beings. I mean, tomorrow, there may be a father who's not going to be separated from his mother, or mother separated from their child because of what the president said last night. And we can't lose sight of that. Had he not done it and we waited for Washington to act, this tragedy would have been replayed daily by the hundreds of thousands, as we've seen in the past few years.
Yeah. Olga.
And with regard to the president's ability to act, he already yesterday, the Department of Homeland Security issued the memo, and they already did the USCIS bulletin. explaining what was going to be the procedure, when was it going to be the application period for like the expansion of DACA. It was going to be in 90 days. It was going to be the application for the parents, spouses, children. It's going to be in 180 days of U.S. citizens. So they've actually kind of laid out already getting everything ready. Now they have to do the application procedure and they have to do all those tidbits and fine tuning, but they have laid out what the game plan is going to be. And they've already issued the orders. And one of those in the priority, in the actual memorandum to the Department of Homeland Security, one of them is the border, securing the border. That is one of the priorities along with criminals and deporting criminals is continuing to secure the borders to make sure that people still aren't coming in. So there is an initiative to do that and to secure that border.
One of the big challenges, Jose, is that you're going to need a budget to implement all of this. You're going to need to hire new personnel and so on. And
but not really, Helen, because
really?
Remember,
okay,
with the actual enforcement of border, yes, because that comes from taxpayers' money. However, the application procedure for any type of person that's applying, a USCIS is funded by its own application fees. So it's not like taxpayer money is paying for it. It's application fees.
Yeah.
Exactly. And right. It's actually creating jobs for the economy because now they got to get more employees to process all these applications.
And that's actually true. So I think USCIS is unique, and we're lucky to know one of our local residents and a great community leader, Emilio Gonzalez, who was a former director of USCIS, but I think he will tell you, and I'm sure you guys live it every day and dealing directly with that agency, is that that is a complicated, messy place, and it is difficult to create new processes. I don't know how they're going to do this in 90 days, frankly. And you guys have lived it with people who have visas that expire and backlogs and all sorts of other issues, paperwork that gets lost. It's improved a lot, but it's not there. So I think that's why you need a more comprehensive solution, because it can't just be USCIS gets their act together, but the other functions don't. Or, you know, one process is being provided for one group of people and not for others. This is the reason why you need a congressional comprehensive reform. But this was a cynical move that poisons the well. And unfortunately, I think it was done with a very calculated and in my opinion, intention to get political benefit and debate the other side.
The first calculation was do it just at the beginning of Latin Grammys, where you're going to have a big Latin Grammy audience. Yeah. Surprise, surprise. Are you disappointed? And we were talking about the unaccompanied minors. According to the information I've seen, they're on the priority list for deportation.
I think these kids need to be helped to the greatest degree possible. And whatever we can do to help them out, we need to help them out. Actually, I think the procedures in place already to help them out are in place. So it's not.
When you say help them out, what does that mean?
Well, they have the ability to go through dependency court in the state courts that they're in. And then they have the ability to apply for a visa to remain in this country.
Then what the administration says, it's not true that they are on the high list of priority to be deported.
I don't believe that's correct.
I think it's they are making account of the people who are entering to the border in the last 5 years. They're saying the most recent, because obviously President Obama doesn't want to say, hey, everybody, come to the United States. He wants to solve the problem that is happening now, which I think everybody wants to do.
But you know what happens, Rudy? Word of mouth gets out. And so what happens is that word of mouth gets out that these children get to stay. And then we go back to the issue of how do you have a control? Everybody wants legal immigration, and we want one that's makes sense for 21st century economy. We want one that makes sense for the millions that are already living here who are undocumented. And I know I'm going to get some emails from some who are going to have a very different perspective. But for many of us, and polls show that the majority of Americans would agree with this, there is that concern that how do you keep control over the borders?
Well, I think you got to address immigration reform in a comprehensive way. And I think I think we could all agree, Democrat or Republican, all of us that care about this issue want to see congressional action. And I hope that the end result of his speech last night is not a Washington that's more divided than ever and that cannot act in a bipartisan manner for long-term reform.
Where do you see the big impediment? You two are the Republicans who are in the know of what's going on
trust.
In Congress.
It's a trust issue.
No, but where do you see the impediment within the Republican Party to keep this from happening? I mean, how do you keep the Ted Cruz's from pulling the party in the direction you think is the wrong way?
We got to do more of what we did this week nationally and locally. You got to have reasonable conservative voices. Jose Mallea and I and you, Helen, were part of a press conference of conservatives calling for congressional action. And in Washington this week, you saw a section in the Washington Times, a conservative-leaning paper in D.C., where Rand Paul, candidate for the presidency, probably for the Republicans, Paul Ryan, now the Ways and Means Chairman, and a conservative by all accounts, Grover Norquist, Susana Martinez, the governor of New Mexico, our own former Governor Jeb Bush, all spoke out in support of comprehensive reform in opinion editorials. Dan Garza, your colleague at Libre, was part of one of those editorials. You saw a letter of major Republican donors to the party, the Norman Bramans of the world, the Mike Fernandez's of the world in this community, and their counterparts nationally.
They signed advocating Norman Brayman, reform. Mike Fernandez, amongst
Remedios
others.
Remedios Díaz-Oliver, I mean, in this community.
This
Dan
letter.
Quayle, the former vice president, Don Evans, the former Secretary of Commerce, Carlos Gutierrez, major leaders within the Republican Party nationally speaking strongly in support of reform. We got to keep that momentum if we're going to be successful in 2016.
What is the biggest challenge that you see very quickly?
Well, I'm very happy to hear this. You know, I think what the president did last night was put this on the table very quickly. And I think hopefully we will have reform. And I think the president really did instigate this whole thing.
And I think, Ellen, honestly, and we spent time on the Hill talking to members of Congress, I think the majority of Republicans want reform. The problem is that there are some nuances as to what the law should look like, right? And that's why you have a process. And you got to let that process play itself out. You need to have that debate on the floor. And you need to have a White House that is working with you and not doing things.
Well, I think you can kiss that part goodbye. But, I mean, I don't know that you're going to see. But we do have a new Congress. And a new Senate being sworn in, and so perhaps that could be different. We saw Carlos Corbello, who is Congressman-elect District 26, issued a statement that was very conciliatory, that he was disappointed, but that he would look forward to working in Congress on this issue in a bipartisan manner. Olga.
I think the issues is like, it's for the Republican and for the Democrats, is the extremes. Everybody needs to come to the table, come to the middle, and come to an agreement. I mean, that's what the process is for Congress, right? To go ahead and everybody's ideas come in, trying to make a representative of the entire United States. The problem is that, and again, is that it's been in the hands of the House for the last 16 months to do that, to shape it the way that they want to shape it so they can do their own proposal. And it's been the inaction of the House. And if not, this wouldn't have been an issue right now because there would have been a bill right now. So the problem is getting the extremes out from both parties and coming to the middle
but
and coming to an agreement.
I always enjoy that Democrats always say that this would be not an issue if Republicans had acted. Of course, the president, instead of health care, could have thrown in immigration as well, because they had one already written up from 2007.
I think it would have been impossible politically for him to have done both.
Listen,
he did Dodd-Frank, Lilly Ledbetter. I don't know. He was all powerful
in his couple of years.
He was really, really powerful.
Dunks,
he still is powerful today.
Slam dunks in politics leave a bitter taste in the opposition's mouth. And in a country where most of the people are in the middle, you got to realize that. The problem with the way that he passed Obamacare is that he didn't care to get a single Republican vote in either chamber. That's why the law now is in approval ratings at 37%. I hope he doesn't do the same thing or insist in the same thing on immigration. He wants to get it all.
Is this his legacy?
And politics requires compromise.
Is this his legacy or is health care his legacy?
I think both are very important. And I think this is giving breathing room for the actual human beings being affected so the parties can work
it out. But how could you refer to this as his legacy when it's a temporary solution? By all accounts, you agree and you work in this space. The people that he's helping deserve a permanent solution to this.
They do, absolutely.
Right? So for
those
him to
people
offer
who are
this
not going to be deported while they work out a permanent solution are going to be helped in very real ways.
And that is the last word. Thanks all for joining me today. I'm